What was required was a zeal and commitment to learn about the place, its civilization, in all its complexity and diversity. A civilization about which another Indian, who was then in distant South Africa, one Mohandas K. Gandhi, would write about powerfully in his manifesto, Hind Swaraj, in a few years. It is that spirit of learning and commitment that animates our own research, scholarship, and teaching about India here at the University of Chicago. Sister Nibedita left her mark on many arenas of Indian life and thought. She established schools for girls. Together with Obanindranath Tagore, Okakura Tenshin, and others, she left her imprint on the Bengal School of Art. She was close friends with the renowned scientist and his wife, Jagadish and Obala Bose. She was also a powerful influence on a strand of Indian nationalism represented by the likes of Aurobindo Ghosh. But no account of Nibedita's career will be complete without acknowledging the impact and imprint of her spiritual mentor, Swami Vivekananda. I said at the beginning that I wanted to speak about two specific instances of Swamiji's relationship to the project of Indian womanhood. Sister Nibedita was my first example. My second and concluding remarks will be about someone who is a household name in Bengal, where I come from, but is little known in the West, or indeed even in other parts of India. She is Sharada Ma, literally Mother Sharada, but as a Bengali, I will refer to her as Sharada Ma. She was the wife of Vivekananda's spiritual guru, the saint Ramakrishna. Swami Gombhiranando's biography of Sharada Ma records Vivekananda declaring, "A slave am I to both of you, and to you both do I prostrate myself." Sharada Ma had no formal education. She was married to Sri Ramakrishna as a child. Yet her life was exemplary of the many things that Swamiji stood for. She arrived in Calcutta from a village, Joyrambati, troubled by reports that her husband had gone mad. It would have been quite natural for a woman of her background to be swayed and terrified by the rumors she heard of his purported lunacy. Instead of being shaken by the sight of his trances, however, Sharada Ma developed a remarkable bond, one might even say a companionate marital bond, with Ramakrishna. Not only did she remain his lifelong consort, accounts of her behavior and comportment after his passing remain exemplary to women to this day. Unlike Hindu widows who shaved their heads or donned white to mark their widowhood, Sharada Ma always wore a plain white sari with a thin red border. In fact, the photographs that we have of her show her dressed like this. Sharada Ma broke many taboos when she welcomed Sister Nibedita and Ms. Bull to her residence in Calcutta and even dined with these visitors in front of her large entourage. The invitation had been extended at Swami Vivekananda's behest. But in associating so freely with mlechas, as foreigners were often referred to, Sharada Ma was in fact issuing a quiet challenge to norms of Hindu caste society and to rules for widows. She traveled widely. Once the Bengal-Nagpur railway was up, she took the train to Puri, which was an important place of pilgrimage. She went to many places in South and Central India. Not simply these well-known places. Reading her biography, one is struck by her remarkable mobility between Calcutta, Joyrambati, which is where she was born, and Kamarpukur, her husband's place of birth. She undertook these journeys with very little money, often under very difficult circumstances. As I mentioned, she was not formally educated, but she maintained the family homes in all three places and was an extremely good manager of money, not because she had any love for lucre or money, but because she had the responsibility of many little girls and widows who lived in her care lifelong. In Sister Nibedita's recollections about Swami Vivekananda, she noted the curiosity and openness with which Sharada Ma listened to resurrection hymns and once even had her, that is Nibedita, enact Christian marriage vows. Let me close with two facts that, for me, captured the courage of this extremely significant woman. First, she was unequivocal in her denunciation of child marriage. She defended two women from Madras, aged 20 and 21 respectively, who studied, they were unmarried, and who studied at the Nivedita school, arguing that education was the most powerful antidote to widowhood. Second, there are numerous incidents in her life where she broke caste and religious taboos. She fed a Muslim man, one Amzad, and washed his plate with her own hands, and rejected all objections to persons of lower caste touching her, or being, in one instance, the pallbearer to a close Brahmin relative. It is no wonder that before he departed for the United States, the one person whose permission Swami Vivekananda sought was that of Sharadama. While his admiration and respect for several American and British women is well known and documented, no account would be complete without also making note of the inspiration of Sharadama, a humble, simple Bengali woman, upon Swami Vivekananda. Thank you.
Friends, I am very happy to be here to take part in this great celebration honoring Swami Vivekananda. This type of personality does not come very often. It takes centuries together to get this type of personality, this Swami Vivekananda. Primarily, he was a man of religion, spirituality, in depth. In addition to that, he had tremendous, extraordinary intellectual attainment. No wonder why great professors of Harvard University, Sir William James, and then many other great scholars of Europe praised this great intellect, Swami Vivekananda. And he himself said that he has given to the world food, of course he meant spiritual food, for 1,500 years. And now we are just observing 150th birth anniversary. He came to Chicago, and by the will of Providence, he selected this place, that means America, to preach his philosophy, religion, and the way of life. He himself said that, "I will not Hinduize my ideas, I will not Christianize my ideas, I will Mayaize my ideas." What is Mayaize? Freedom. Freedom was his voice, freedom was his religion, and freedom was his way of life. No wonder why he selected America to preach his voice of freedom. Because, in my opinion, you know, I have traveled Europe and many places, only here in America you enjoy maximum freedom. Of course, I must point out to you know, I love Mark Twain. Mark Twain used to say, by the will of God, of course, not exactly these words, he says, "In this country we are blessed with three unspeakable things. Number one, freedom of speech. Number two, freedom of conscience. Number three, and the prudence never to practice either of them. I love Mark Twain. He is humorous, but very meaningful. So Vivekananda selected this particular country to preach the voice of age-old Eastern mysticism, as you call Vedanta, or in broadly speaking, Hinduism, in and through America. Like Buddha selected Sarnath to preach his message of compassion. Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, here we find Vivekananda preached his message here, right here in Chicago. Can you imagine, in 1893, he came here unknown. Now everybody knows, everywhere you go in America, there will be yoga parlor, yoga studio, yoga. Everybody says, Swami, I'm going to do yoga. It was good. Now it is known. But it was he, Vivekananda, who first brought to the Western Hemisphere what yoga is. Just analyze these few words that Vivekananda, who was unknown in Chicago, in front of thousands of people, most of them unknown to him, he started his lecture just saying these few words. You all know it. What are those? Just sisters and brothers of America. What is the magic spell in these few words that everybody rose to give him a standing ovation? What is there? He was not their guru. Look at our dear dean. She is with Indian dress, sari. Now, in those days, who knew? Nobody knew Vivekananda. They are all Americans. Why did they give standing ovation to this unknown person? Of course, to some intellectuals, he was known, like Harvard University professors and few others. Not all. Just analyze those words, sisters and brothers of America. Of course, in America we are indebted to Emerson and Thoreau because they actually brought American soil Eastern mysticism, wisdom, Bhagavad Gita and Vedanta, Thoreau and Emerson. That started the transcendental movement of America. So America actually was awakened to the fact that it needed spirituality. But spirituality can never be given by intellect. It's a life. Life gives spirituality. So America needed some model, as you call nowadays, and everything is a model. Everything is a model, you see. So they needed some model of what spirituality is, what religion is, what divinity means. That was Vivekananda. So as soon as he came, they could understand, they could feel it, that here is divinity on earth. Nobody need to speak. So the moment he started saying, they could feel it. He's our own. And Vivekananda could feel, they are my own. They are not stranger. I'm not speaking to stranger. They're all my own. That is actually the message of unity in diversity. See, look at the whole world. We're all different. And that is the law of nature. I cannot eat the same food. The moment I go to any store, in fact, I had trouble. When I first came to this country in 91, I went to one store. Here, names are very interesting. The one store is called Safeway. I asked, is there any danger way? You know, they have different names. And they are good in America in coining the names. They call Bed, Bath and Beyond. You know, many times I take those words, that life, death and beyond. Is it like that? So when I went to get a piece of bread, I was totally confused. What was that? There are like 120 kinds of bread. What? Then I asked the manager, why don't you keep computer here? There I will put what I want, what I do not want. Let him select what bread I want. Because we all eat different things. We all have different dresses. And we all think different thoughts. It is the law of nature. We cannot be one. And our Vedanta teachers thousands of years ago knew that. So they started their journey of search, inquiry. They had extraordinary power of introspection. So they first found in the world that there are two things. Number one, sukha, pleasure, dukkha, unhappiness, sorrow. Pleasure and sorrow. These two looks like they are two opposite. Then they found no. They are not two opposite. They are only one and the same different. It reminds me of, I'm sure you have watched George Burns, Oh God, number one, two, three. I like Oh God, number two. There George Burns acts the role of God. And the little girl, I think her name is Tracy. So Tracy asked George Burns, God, can I ask you a question? Yes. Why did you make people suffering? I feel sad. Then George Burns, God, in the role, asked, can you give me a coin with only one side? No, every coin has two sides. Well, Tracy, there you go. Wherever there is sorrow, there is good, there is bad, together. Suppose here is a beautiful altar here. Suppose I take beautiful flower, very fragrant, very sweet smile comes out. After a few days, you will say, Swami, can you remove it? Because it is awful. It is awful smell. So good turns out to be bad. And then again, that bad thing, if I keep in the garden, it will be like a compost. Out of that, good thing comes. See? So good and bad, our teachers found, they are not separate. So they found the unity in the external universe. But that did not satisfy our previous teachers of thousands of years old. Then they went down, down and down into inquiry. Then the question arose. In the Upanishad, the teaching you'll find, the student asked the teacher question. That is in Sanskrit, Kosminu Bhagavo Vigyate Sarvam Idam Vigyatam Bhavati Iti. O teacher, O adorable sir, is there something by knowing which I know everything? It is just like different ornaments made out of gold. It is not possible for me to know all the different countries made different types of ornaments. But if I know the gold, I know everything. So that was the question raised thousands of years ago. And the teachers went down deep into their introspection, meditation. There they found that was the teaching which was brought by Vivekananda to America, and in and through America he preached unity in diversity. We are all one. We are all one. We can never be two. During my lecture in the East Coast, one time I told, God is present even in hell. Then somebody called me, I think from Princeton University. Swami, do you remember he told that God is present even in hell too? I said, did I? Yeah. Well, do not you say God is omnipresent? Yeah. So how can you say God is omnipresent? Then you have to say God is present minus hell. Yeah, that makes sense. See, so our teachers thousands of years ago found that no hell. It reminds me of, that is my favorite, you know, John Lennon. I went to see his house, John Lennon in New York. I always like that. Imagine no possessions. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man, imagine. All the people, I cannot sing those, you know, sharing the world. That is my most favorite. That how we see Vivekananda preached in and through America, that very tone which was actually given to us long time ago by Emerson. Emerson said, in all nations, there are minds which incline to dwell in the conception of the fundamental unity, the raptures of prayer and ecstasy of devotion, love all being in one being. This tendency finds its highest expression in the religious writings of the East and chiefly in the Indian scriptures, in the Vedas, the Bhagavad Gita and Vishnu Purana. These were the words of Emerson. Now we find that John Lennon, I like that song, John Lennon, I can listen over and over again, that John Lennon. I hope sometimes you can sing here. Now, that what I was telling, that sisters and brothers of America, there you find, we get that concept, that idea, that we are all one. We cannot be many. You know, Mahatma Gandhi one time wrote something to an American missionary who claimed that Christian way is the best for all. Then Mahatma Gandhi wrote, I want to share with you, beautiful. He wrote, Mahatma Gandhi, you assume knowledge of all people which you can do only if you are a God. I want you to understand that you are laboring under a double fallacy, that what you think best for you is really so, and that what you regard as best for you is the best for the whole world. It is an assumption of omniscience and infallibility. I plead for a little humility. These are the words of great soul Mahatma Gandhi. See, Martin Luther King said, Junior, we must learn to live together as brothers, or we are going to perish together as fools. So now, thanks to the advancement of technology, because nowadays everything is, you can get in your hand. I like Steve Jobs, who created iPhone, because everything is, of course I don't say iPhone, I call Dowphone. Dowphone, Dowpod, Dowpad. The more you say iPhone, iPad, then you are in trouble. iPad. Not I, but thou and thou. And I'm glad that Steve Jobs wrote small I, not big I. You see? I like that. Small I, not big I. So little I, little ego, discard it. That's what Swami Vivekananda did. That he was one with the divine, one with God. And that's what he could see, the divinity of all. Just imagine, in those days Swami Vivekananda openly declared that you are all not born sinners. You are all born gods. You are all born Buddhas. You are all born Christs. He did not say these words. I'm just telling. That is his message. Vivekananda said that. He himself said in California that the Buddha, Jesus are the waves of the infinite ocean. That I am. So that is the teaching of Vivekananda, that you all are sleeping Buddhas, sleeping Jesus, sleeping Vivekananda, and then you have to wake it up. And Vivekananda came to America to wake up that spirit of America. And now we see everywhere that spirit is awakening, and we try to see. Look at our great dear deal. She greeted me saying Namaste. Can you believe that? That is our way of greeting. What that mean? Te means you. Namo means greet. I greet you. Not that as human. Not that as man. Not that as dean. No. But I greet you as God is in you. I don't care whether you accept Jesus. Doesn't matter. I salute Jesus in you. If you accept Buddha, I salute Buddha in you. If you do not believe in anything, it doesn't matter. I salute your real infinite nature within you. That was Vivekananda's voice, and we need very much today. Now, no religion can retreat from mingling with everybody and anybody, because nowadays everything is Facebook, this book, Twitter, whatever happens anywhere in the world, we all know. The more we come together and together, we need this unique message of Vivekananda, that unity in diversity, we are all one. God is not a Christian, God is not Muslim, God is not Hindu, God is God. So I must finish my talk with the great prayer. What Swami Vivekananda did in Chicago, this is the book. I will request Swami Sarvatmananda later on to get these copies. I'm sure we have got in our center, called Chicago Addresses by Swami Vivekananda. What extraordinary language of English and the inspirational words that was Swami Vivekananda. So I conclude with the prayer what he did, Swami Vivekananda. He said, may he who is the Brahman of the Hindus, the Ahura Mazda of the Zoroastrians, the Buddha of the Buddhists, the Jehovah of the Jews, the Father in Heaven of the Christians, give strength to you to carry out your noble idea. The star arose in the east, it travels steadily towards the west, sometimes dimmed and sometimes effulgent, till it made a circuit of the world, and now it is again rising on the very horizon of the east, the borders of the Sanpo a thousandfold more effulgent than it ever was before. Thank you.
Thank you. The Bengali Association of Greater Chicago is honored and privileged to celebrate the great son of Bengal, Swami Vivekananda's 150th birth anniversary in Chicago. In 1893, a young Hindu monk from India, Swami Vivekananda, braved all odds and traveled from India to America. He came to this great city of Chicago and at the World Parliament of Religions in September 1893 for the In 1893, a young Hindu monk from India, Swami Vivekananda, braved all odds and traveled from India to America. He came to this city of Chicago and at the World Parliament of Religions in September 1893, for the first time, brought the ideals and philosophy of Hinduism to the world stage. Our first song celebrates Swami Vivekananda, the soldier, who despite many hardships came to an unknown land armed only with his deep belief in God and his guru, Sri Ramakrishna's teachings. He conquered an audience of skeptics at the Parliament of Religions, using nothing more than his words of love and tolerance for all. Our first song, Sanyasi Shainik.
Ek sanyasi shainik, ek sanyasi shainik. Tumi darale Chicago dharma shabhay nirbhay nirbhik. তুমি দাঁড়ালে শিকাগো ধর্ম সভায় নির্ভয় নির্ভীক এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনিক এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনিক
কাচের ঝঞ্ঝা তুমি আলোকবর্তিকা প্রাচ্যের ঝঞ্ঝা তুমি বেটভেনের সুরে তুলিলে ধর্ম বারতা হে কুমার জয় তব জয় 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 তব জয় জয় এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী মন্দ্রিত কণ্ঠে সবার ডাকিলে অমৃত পুত্র মন্দ্রিত কণ্ঠে সবার ডাকিলে অমৃত পুত্র বাবা বিষয়ে শুনিল বিশ্ববাসী বীর সন্ন্যাসী কণ্ঠে ধরিছে ঈশ্বরের বাণী জয় তব জয় জয় এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী তুমি দাঁড়ালে শিকাগো ধর্ম সভায় নির্ভয় নির্ভীক তুমি দাঁড়ালে শিকাগো ধর্ম সভায় নির্ভয় নির্ভীক এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী এক সন্ন্যাসী সৈনী
স্বামীজি First received enlightenment and spiritual guidance before Mother Kali Our next song, Shama Maki Amar Kalore, is an invocation to the Mother Kali.
कालो रे शमा माँ की आमार कालो लोके बाले काली कालो आमार मन तो बाले ना कालो रे कालो रूपे दिगाम्बरी कालो रूपे दिगाम्बरी रिदि पाद करे मोरा दुरे शमा माँ की आमार कालो शमा कखनो शेतो कखनो पीतो कखनो नीलो नरितो रे कखनो शेतो कखनो पीतो कखनो